Friends, what are the seven links to awakening? They are: 1. Awareness is a link to awakening. Sati Sambhuyanga. 2. Curious investigation is a link to awakening. Vichaya Sambhuyanga. 3. Enthusiastic energy is a link to awakening. Virya Sambhuyanga. 4. Rapturous joy is a link to awakening. Piti Sambhuyanga. 5. Tranquility is a link to awakening. Pasati Sambhuyanga. 6. Concentration is a link to awakening. Samadhi Sambhuyanga. 7. Equanimity. Serene equanimity is a link to awakening. Upekkha Sambhuyanga. Those whose mind are well developed in these seven factors of self-awakening, who delight in non-clinging, who relinquish all grasping, whose mind are all around luminous, whose mental fermentations are all stilled, they, even while still in this world, are all unbound right here. And how, friends, when the four foundations of awareness have been developed, when they have been made much of, do they complete the seven wings to awakening, the seven links to enlightenment? At the time when a friend is living in contemplating the body as a frame, just a disgusting form, enthusiastic, clearly conscious, continually aware of it, so as to control all desire and aversion for bodies and forms in this world. At that time, undisrupted awareness is aroused in this friend. At the time, friends, when undisrupted awareness is aroused in such a friend, at that time the link to awakening, that is awareness, is stirred up in this friend. Later, over a period, such friend develops a link to awakening, that is awareness. And finally, by this development, the link to awakening, that is awareness, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this noble friend. Living thus aware, awake, mindful, such curious, an interested friend examines, inquires into, bring this thing forward for his investigations, bring this thing forward for investigation by means of insight. At the time, friends, when such a friend, living thus aware, mindfully examines, inquires into, and bring all things and phenomena forward for investigation by means of insight. At that time, the link to awakening, that is investigation, is stirred up in this friend. Later, over a period, this friend develops the link to awakening, that is investigation. Finally, the link to awakening, that is investigation into phenomena, comes to complete fulfillment and development in this fine. While such a friend is thus examining, inquiring into, bringing phenomena forward for investigations by means of insight, then enthusiastic and unsluggish energy is stirred up in this friend. At the time, friends, when unsluggish energy and enthusiasm is stirred up in a friend who is examining, who inquires into, and who brings all things and phenomena forward for investigations by means of insight, at that time the link to awakening, that is energy, is stirred up in such a friend, Later, over a period, such friend develops a link to awakening, that is energy. And finally, this link to awakening, that is energy, and Hangchushesim, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this keen, eager, enthusiastic, and devoted friend. When such a friend has stirred up energy, unsolid joy arises. At the time, friends, when unsolid joy arises in a friend of stirred up energy, at that time the link to awakening, that is joy, is stirred up in such a friend. Later, over a period, these friends develop this link to awakening, that is joy. Finally, this link to awakening, that is joy, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this now ever glad friend. The body of one whose mind is in joy, as happy as one can be, is tranquilized. And thinking too is tranquilized. At the time when both the body of a friend whose mind is in joy is tranquilized, and any thinking too is all tranquilized. And that time the link to awakening, that is tranquility, is stirred up in such a friend. Later, over a period, this friend develops a link to awakening, that is tranquility. Finally, this link to awakening, that is tranquility, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this calmed and now serene friend. The thought of one whose body is thus tranquil and at ease is concentrated. At the time when thought is concentrated in one whose body is tranquil and at ease, at that time the link to awakening, that is concentration, is stirred up in such a friend. Later, over a period, this friend develops a link to awakening, that is concentration. Finally, a link to awakening, that is concentration, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this well-focused, ever undistracted friend. Such noble friend is one who looks with proper care at the thought and thinking thus concentrated. At the time when a friend looks with proper care at the thought concentrated thus, at that time the link to awakening, that is equanimity, a solid, even mental balance, is stirred up in such friend. Later, over a period, this friend develops a link to awakening, that is equanimity. Finally, the link to awakening, that is equanimity, comes to complete fulfillment of development in this friend. When such a friend is faring along, contemplating the feelings just as responses, the mind just as moods, and all phenomena just as mental states, enthusiastic, clearly conscious of them, continually aware of them, he will control any desire and any dejection regarding all phenomena in this world. At that time, the link to awakening, that is equanimity, comes to fulfillment of development in this friend. Friends, the four foundations of awareness, when developed thus, made much of thus, refined thus, brings to fulfillment the seven links to awakening. And how, friends, when the seven links have been developed, how, when they are made much of, do they bring to fulfillment freedom through knowledge? Herein, friends, a friend develops a link to awakening, that is awareness, dependent on aloofness, dependent on detachment, dependent on ceasing, ending in relinquishment. The friend develops a link to awakening, that is investigation into phenomena. The link to awakening, that is energy. The link to awakening, that is joy. The link to awakening, that is tranquility. the link to awakening that is concentration, and the link to awakening that is equanimity, dependent on aloofness, dependent on detachment, dependent on ceasing, culminating in relinquishment. Friends, when the seven links of awakening are developed thus, are made much of thus, are refined thus, they bring to utter fulfillment freedom through knowledge. Thus spoke the Lord. Delighted, these bhikkhus rejoiced in what the Lord Buddha had said. Thank you. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 82, recorded on the 17th November 2017 on planet Earth in the Cypress Hermitage and Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka, on a lovely day. Small clouds, no wind, bright sun, 25 degrees. Hopefully, the recording and what is communicated today will be as pleasant as this day is. First, there come a lotus offering, and this is from Robert Zach Juno from Ohio, USA, which dedicated the merit to himself, his wife, his mother and father, and his five children. Unfortunately, my camera phone ran out of juice, so it's very short, but it comes right here.
You friends, this magnificent, magnificent flower offering of, I think, 100 lotuses, actually more, I think 105 lotuses, is an offering from Mr. Robert Jono of Ohio, USA, and he's offering these lotuses, dedicating the merit to his wife, his five children, and his mother and father. And I'm also myself personally participating in this flower offering to the Lord Buddha's tooth, which lies up in the temple, which you see right over there. Pass in through this door over there, up to the temple yard, and in and offer the lotuses right there. Thank you.
So much for offering over 100 lotuses. Was a magnificent sight. And many rejoiced when they see me coming, walking with this mountain of lotuses. So congratulations to Robert Juno of Ohio, USA. And here comes the construction report. And I'd like to say thank you again to the supporters who construct this project of building a meditation hall for the benefit of the many. May all beings, or many of them at least, become happy thereby. And the construction report comes right here.
Here you see the sand. There's approximately 50 bags there of 35 kilos. The guys are carrying up. This is at 3,000 feet. They go up to 4,800 feet, which is up there behind this, up in the mist there. There's another staircase there. So this is the first station, then there's a second station, and then it comes up to the Bhavana-Sala. We put it into plastic because otherwise the rain will make the sand wet. And if the sandbags become wet, then become close to 45 kilos. And then also one will have water, dirty water running down the neck when carrying them up. So this carrying up is a really difficult task to get the sand and cement up here. This is only the sand. Then comes 1 ton of cement. Has to be hand carried up all the way down from this village. Lying down there, you cannot see it now down there. But down there somewhere, come up here, up through this path. And then you put it here. Store it here, then go further up this path, up towards this tree up there, store it on the other side of the hill, And then go further up, up to the Bhavanakuti, where we are making the meditation hall for all beings to become happy, calm, clear, and content. Thank you for your attention, consideration, and contribution, and have a nice day.
Hello to you, friends. This is just to update you on the meditation hall. The iron has been carried up here, and half of the sand, that's a significant part of the work, is to carry this sand, 35 kilos per bag, up here in 4,000 feet elevation, because there's no road access. Next up is a cement bag, 20 cement bags. So tomorrow we will start to bend these iron rods and make the armament for this wall that will be a part of the foundation, one quarter of the foundation for the meditation hall. I just like to say then, thanks for your keen attention, clever consideration and kind contribution. We have just started building the meditation hall, which is very necessary because it's raining up here. It's not raining now, drizzling. And I'll make some video, there will come some video about it next week. But donations and support for this meditation roof for meditators that comes up here is very welcome still. And it's this, of course, enables them to approach Nirvana. And when you give somebody else the opportunity to approach Nirvana, then you get the very same thing back from the karmic mirror that reflects this good opportunity giving back to the donor. So this is worth remembering, giving others opportunity to reach deathlessness thereby increases one's probability and ability to gain this very same deathlessness, this very same Nirvana, this very same irreversible end of suffering, this very same lasting happiness oneself. Worth remembering is that Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa.
Actually, when working myself on this project of building a meditation hall, I feel a great satisfaction because I know I do something good for others. And when you do something altruistic, then you also feel a great satisfaction. You are like lighted up by an inner fire and become very happy and satisfied by doing this good. Knowing that many of the donors and many others also, of course, will come and meditate in this meditation hall for the next 20 years. This makes me very happy. So they can approach Nirvana. They can become more free, more happy, more peaceful, and have a greater insight into the absolute nature of reality.
So much for building meditation halls. We go to the question. Question 244. A, how does a stream enter, a Sotapanna, know that he is a stream enter, know this attainment for sure? Is it when the three fetters are eliminated, the samyoyanas, or is it when the teacher declares it? First, I'd like to say that it's very difficult. It's a difficult question, actually. And it's the reason why the Buddha, he waited as long as he could and said, now I cannot be blamed for leading people into self-deception by setting forth this teaching of the four stages of nobility. The stream entra, the Sotapanna, the Sakadagami, the once returner, and the Anagami, the never returner, and the Arahat. Because he knew in advance, because of this self-love, this ego gratification, that people will fall in love with these titles groundlessly. So it is a tricky issue. Actually, let's take the teacher first. When the teacher declares it, if the teacher himself is a stream enterer or above that, then he can recognize another one. But if he's not a stream entrant, then he cannot recognize whether a pupil is a stream entrant or not. And the case is unfortunately fairly often that teachers that think that they are stream entrants and have deceived themselves, they start to point out other stream entrants that are not stream entrants. And this can go on, go into the extreme. In the 70s, there was a case reported from Burma where the local chief monk in a given district, he should send in a list to the government how many nobles there were in his district. And then suddenly this government authority, they received list where there were 10 small school children, 10-year-old girls and boys that were mentioned as arahants. So this, that was going complete inflation in this title putting on. And this was in an orthodox Theravada country in the 70s. So people went around and designated various peoples as nobles that were not noble at all. And even pointed out 10-year-old schoolgirls as awakened beings. So it just says something about this self-deception, how tricky it can be, how tricky it can be. What is a stream entrant? Per definition, seen from the Buddhist point of view, it is one who has eliminated the three fetters or the three lower chains, of which there is five, the samyoyanas. The Blessed Buddha, he once emphasized, because there are these five lower mental chains, five fetters, five samyoyanas. What five? The mental chain of belief in my same identity, sakkaya ditti. The mental chain of skeptical doubt, vichikicca. The mental chain of clinging to rule and ritual, silabatta paramasa, paramasa, and the mental chain of lust for sensuality, sense desire, kamaraga, the mental chain of anger or ill will, vyapada. There exist these five mental chains. Noble Eightfold Way should be developed for the direct experience of these five fetters, for the full understanding and elimination of them, and for their final overcoming, destruction, and full abandonment. The Noble Eightfold Way is developed for the breaking asunder of these five mental chains. Go to buddhaset.net and look for the five lower chains. So let's take them again. The first one was this belief in a person, in a me. You can also call it personality belief, sakkaya ditti. Actually, ditti means view, sakkaya, this group, is own group view, is direct translation. So it's a being which believes that there is a ego or a self in form, feeling, perception, mental construction or consciousness. That this is me, this is what I am. This is what I own, or I'm independent of that. So there are 20 kinds of that, and I will go through them systematically. One can say from a practical, pragmatic point of view, let's say you go out and brush your teeth in front of the mirror, and if you see, then you see a form in the mirror, then if you say, ah, this is me, then this is sakkaya ditti, this wrong view, this personality belief. Because deep, basically, what you see in the mirror is a form and color. It's a reflection, it's a perception. It's not a me in any case whatsoever. If you look at this body and say, ah, this body is mine, this is what I am, this is personality belief. If you have pain in the knee and say, ah, this is my pain, or I'm inside this pain, this pain belongs to me, or the pain is inside me, then it's also personality belief. If you say these mental constructions, these ideas, hopes, intentions, longings, dreamings, dreams, they are me, a part of me, what I am, what I'm made out of, then it's personality belief. If you say this consciousness is me, is mine, or I am inside this consciousness, or this consciousness is inside me, or I'm apart from this consciousness, I'm independent of this consciousness, or I own this consciousness. In any case, as it may be, then there is the wrong view of Sakkaya Ditti. And then one is not a stream entrant. One is not a stream entrant. This one can exclude by this clinging adherence. And one should be brutally honest there and really scrutinize it, whether one ascribes to one of these 20 kinds of false view I'll now mention. One, myself is identical with my body. This physical matter is my ego. Myself, me, mine, has a body. This physical matter is owned by my ego. This frame is owned by myself. Myself is hidden somewhere inside and included in this body frame. Or the body is hidden inside and including this all-pervading ego, self, me, mine. So much for the body, identifying with the body. This is the most common thing. Perceive looking yourself in the mirror. And then say, what you see in the mirror, this is me. Looking at your own hand, limbs, genitals, feet, this is me, this is mine, this is what I am. This is what I'm made of. So this is a self-projection into form, rupa. Five, myself is identical with my feelings of pain, pleasure, and neutral feeling. This is my ego. Myself has feelings. It owns feelings. These sensations are owned by myself, my ego. Myself is hidden inside among these feelings, included within these emotions. All these feelings are hidden inside and included within my all-pervading ego self. So this again, this is pain, pleasure, and neutral feeling, whether physical or mental. Ah, this is me. This is mine. These feelings are mine. It is a me who have these feelings, who own these feelings, who experience these feelings. No, there's just feeling. It's same with the body, there is a frame, there's form, internal form, external form. It's not a me, it's not a mind. It's not a myself. Neither is it the same from one moment to the next moment. And the same goes for feeling. Myself is identical with my perceptions, my experiences. These experiences are my ego. Myself has these perceptions. These experiences are owned by my very own self and ego. Myself is hidden inside these perceptions, included among all these experiences, somewhere. These experiences are hidden and hidden inside and included inherently within my ego self. These experiences are in my brain, in my mind. No. Perception arises and ceases. When there's contact, passa. When there's an eye, sensitivity of the eye, when there's an external form, and when there wishes consciousness, well, then there's perception. Perception itself doesn't include a perceiver. Just like a camera, the camera that records this video now, it records this specific visual information and auditory information, but there's no self, no ego. No me, no mine, inside this camera that stands in front of me. There's not. And neither is there inside this recorder, this camera of visual and auditory and tactile, gustatory and olfactory information. There is not. Myself is identical with my mental constructions. Ideas and intentions are myself, my ego. Myself possesses mental constructions. These hopes, intentions, activities are owned by my ego. Myself is hidden inside these mental constructions, included as a core. And these cogitations are hidden and inside and included inherently within my ego self. I'm a summation of my dreams, my intentions, my conceptual thinking. This is what I am. This is what characterizes my personality. No. There is thinking. There is intention. There is dreaming. There is hoping. But there's no me, no doer, no dreamer. It's just activities, impersonal, conditioned activities that arise and cease according to their own circumstances, causes and conditions. Not because they are initiated or owned by a self, a ego, a me, a mine. Myself is hidden. Oh, myself is identical with my consciousness. This is the most difficult one. This bare awareness is my ego. Myself has consciousness or is conscious. This naked awareness is owned by my ego. Myself is hidden inside this consciousness, included in all aware moments. All this consciousness is hidden inside and included inherently within myself. So there's consciousness itself, that self, an imaginary self, is projected into consciousness. And because you cannot see consciousness, it's because so all-pervading, seen, and circumstance for all existence, then it's very natural to, as a last defense against the no-self, anatta principle, deposit an ego inside the consciousness. Or say that consciousness is owned by a self, an ego, a personality, a me, a mine. Nevertheless, as soon as this ego, this imaginary ego, which is an informational structure, a so-called wrong view inside the computer, it thinks it identifies with itself, then it makes a prison that it cannot come out of. As soon as it's identified with form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness, then it cannot come out of samsara. Because it thinks it is a certain thing, and this put up some invisible bars. And it's these bars that are broken down at stream entry. Then the person ditch it and say no more of that. Because the person has seen the Four Noble Truths in a glimpse to the extent that it knows that any form is suffering, any feeling is suffering, any perception is suffering, any mental construction is suffering, and any form of consciousness also is suffering. Because the being has seen that, and have eradicated skeptical doubt in that First Noble Truth, then it doesn't identify with this suffering. Because the other thing is driven by this self-love, that the ego, immediately, as soon as this has formed itself as an informational structure, then it tragically and dramatically, violently falls in love with itself. And this is the most tragic romance in world history. This is what this love affair beings had with their own ego, with their own self, which is imaginary, which is non-existent, that actually ends up destroying themselves because of egoistic behavior. Then it gives also rise to overblown pride, egocentrism, arrogance, and all these kinds of stuff. So it's a kind of auto-cannibalism, because it's repeated life after life. So when the ego believes it is an ego, then it keeps killing itself by coming back into samsara, being reborn into samsara. So it's a very frantic and cruel and obsessive self-deception. So it's an imaginary self that deceives itself about a self. So there's a self-deception in the third degree. Why can there not be any self in there? Because self includes a criteria of sameness. It should be the same self. But no form is the same from one moment to the next. No feeling, perception, mental construction, or consciousness is the same from one moment to the next. How can there be any same self inside these or outside these five activities, flowing phenomena. There cannot be. So neither can there be any outside them, these five clusters of clinging, nor can there. People say, ah, okay, maybe I'm not my body, maybe I'm not my feeling, maybe I'm not my perceptions, maybe I'm not my mental constructions or consciousness. But if we put them all five together in a mix pot and then mix them together, then there is a self. There's a emerges a self down there in this mix pot. But that's not the case, because if there's no self, neither in form, feeling, perception, mental construction or consciousness, then neither can there be any self in a collection of them. If you add them together, then there's still no self. Huh? This doctrine of selflessness, of anatta, not anyone, anything, anywhere, is particular to the Buddhas, because you cannot teach him from anywhere else. And it's a bar that has to be lifted to go out of samsara. As long as the self is there as an informational structure that loves itself, then it will keep coming back to samsara to gratify this self with sense pleasure. It will keep doing it, and thereby it will keep coming back to aging, sickness and death, and thereby it will keep coming back to suffering. So it has to be lifted. The Blessed Buddha once radically pointed out, all phenomena is void of a self or of what belongs to any self. Within this frame, there's nothing belonging to anyone, anywhere, nor is there anything owned by this frame in anyone, anywhere, or elsewhere. So forget about it. So forget this ego. See the conditions arise and cease, internally, externally, but don't project an ego or self or me or mine in them. So much for this ego projection. You can go to whatbuddhasaid.net and then search for ego projection. It's in the first drops. I can recommend that, because thinking about it again and again makes this ego projection become weaker and weaker and weaker and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until there is release from it. Then one has lifted the first bar, sakkaya ditti, the belief in a non-existent self. Then comes the next bar, this is skeptical doubt, vichikicca. It's one of the five mental hindrances, nivarana. It's also one of the three fetters that we are discussing here, the samyoyanas, which disappear at stream entry, sotapanna. Skeptical doubt is actually about six things. First of all, and they come in consequence of each other. If one has skeptical doubt in the unsurpassably perfect self-enlightenment of the master, the Buddha, then one has skeptical doubt. And this leads to also that one has skeptical doubt in the teaching of the Dhamma, whether it's good or bad, whether it's perfect or not. If the Buddha is not perfectly self-enlightened, then the Dhamma teaching he sets forth is also not. As soon as one believes that, then one cannot approach it, or be dedicated to it, be confirmed in it. Because one has this skeptical doubt, maybe it's so, maybe it's not so. One has skeptical about the noble community of the Sangha, the Arya Sangha, a subset of the Sangha, those who are from stream entry and upwards. Very, very small subset. One out of a million, let's say, of Sangha that normally we will say is composed of the Samuji Sangha, the conventional Sangha, is lay people that has taken the Buddha Dhamma Sangha as their teacher, has taken the refuge and the five precepts. Lay people, male and female, and monks and nuns. This is Samuji Sangha, the conventional Sangha. But the Arya Sangha is only those who are from stream entry and upwards. If one have skeptical doubt in them, in this small, very pure subset, rare to meet, then one has skeptical doubt. Then one is not a stream entrant. If one has skeptical doubt in the training of meditation and in Dhamma study, and thereby in calm and insight, in the efficacy of calm and insight, samadha vipassana, then one is also skeptical about, then one is not a stream entry yet. Which one has doubt about the past and the future? And lastly, if one has doubt about conditionality and causality, that is basically about the principle of dependent co-arising, paticca-samuppada. If one has doubt about whether this works or not, whether this is an accurate description of causality, cause and effect, then one is not a stream entrant. Yet. Then there's the last samyoyana, silabhatta paramasa, clinging to rule and rituals. This is holding firmly to the view that one mere by rules or rituals alone can reach mental purification. This is called clinging to rules and rituals. Typically, you will see in the abroad case that people say, if I grow very long hair, then I become a holy man. Or if I have a very long beard, then I become a holy man. Or if I paint my face in special colors or wear special earrings or do special rituals, and then I become a holy man, then I can reach enlightenment by that alone. And by living by certain rules, for example, not killing or being vegetarian or so on. And this alone is enough for mental purification, but this is not the case. You can burn as many incense sticks as you want. Greed will still be there. And the same thing about other kind of ritual things, which is basically a cultural phenomenon. They don't guarantee any decrease of greed, hate and ignorance. And as long as that is the case, then obviously mental purification is not fulfilled, it's not completed. So rule and rituals is not a love alone. There has to be calm and insight also. There has to be meditation. There has to be Dhamma study. There has to be made a serious effort in reflection upon the nature of samsara, the Four Noble Truths. There has to be. Incense sticks and even lotus offerings are not enough alone by them themselves. It's a good start, you can say. The five precepts is a good start. It's the foundation for spiritual development. But it's not the end. It's not the tower. It's the first step on this way out of samsara. So much for this dream intro and how to attain it, how to evaluate whether you have this attainment or not. Next question is question 245. What about a person who has grossly and numerously broken the precepts, the five precepts, when earlier in his life, but then later live virtuously and devoted to the Dhamma the rest of his or her life? Yeah, it depends, I would say. All karma is mixed. This also goes for Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and anyone, Arahats. They have also done something in the past that was evil. So you can say it's a wave of probability that is born at the moment when performs an action, there's a wave of probability that is exhausted in time. And if you do something good, there'll be up wave. And then you do something, small points of evil, as you see on this summation here. The green upwards is good doings and the red downwards is bad doings. And then they will result in pleasure or pain if you sum them up. So probabilities are additive. So let's say, for example, you do an action that entails that you exactly in 1 year from now, at the very second, same second, will have a pleasant feeling or will have success, external success and internal pleasant feeling. And the chances that you deposit for that gives an 80% probability to have this pleasant feeling and have this external success 1 year from now. Well, then you do five actions down the road and they all is subtract 20%. This 3 times 20% of bad karmas down the road, and then we should sum them up at 60%, and you had 80% to start with, then you have 20% left. This is just a very simplified case, of course. Huh? So all karma is mixed, so it cannot be said what the consequence will be, because one cannot escape one karma. One can modify it, and one should keep good doing. However, it is usually the case, and the Buddha said this several times, that the bad doer, the evil doer, the wrong doer, the careless, neglectful person that comes out of this neglect, is like the moon freed from clouds, right? You cannot see the moon, cannot shine through the clouds, the mental defilements, but suddenly the cloud comes away, and then you can't see the moon, then the moon shines up everything. And the person that leaves this neglect, this carelessness, is like this moon that suddenly comes out of the cloud and starts shining. And this, I think, is a very poetic and also very good way of looking at it, that one should never give up, irrespective of what there is in the past. Actually, if there was whatever evil there was in the past, it's not an argument for stopping the training. Actually, it's an argument for intensifying the training, intensifying the purification, the mental purification, to compensate out these bad effects from the past. So one cannot say anything, I cannot say anything from this description when a person who has grossly and numerously broken the precepts in the past and now are living devoted to the Dhamma. Generally, I would say it's a good prognosis, but it will be a bumpy road because there are these things that has been parked, deposited, probabilities in the past that eventually, inevitably, will fall out in the future. The magnitude they will fall out with becomes smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, the more good doing one do now. So the more giving, the more meditation, the more Dhamma study, the more insistence on the five precepts one do now, this will diminish, reduce the effects of the bad wrongdoing in the past. So one should push for it, for good doing, for mental training, for purification. The Buddha says very acutely, they ask him how acutely, as if your hair were in fire, he said. Or they say as going along a road or something. No, it says just as if you have only one spoonful of food to swallow. It's like that. You have only one chance more. Don't delay it and say, I can do it next year or tomorrow or later on. As soon as one starts delaying good doing, start delaying the mental training, then one starts backsliding until there's a karmic crash, falls into bad habits again, drugging and so on, lying, hustling, and then down the drain of karma. So one should be very astute with it. And then I would say it's good not to kind of like look long in forward and say, what may it be that like this, it may be like that, blah, blah, blah. If one doesn't know how it will be, and this is in almost all cases the case, except if one has the divine eye, the deeper chakra, enlightened beings, basically. One should focus on right here now and do good right here now. Find the optimum behavior right here now and keep on doing that, staying real. And the situation that is real right here and now. And then get the best out of it. And then whatever there was will evaporate in the future if one keeps on doing the ideal according to the Dhamma in whatever moment there is, forever here on, until samsara has ended, until reach enlightenment. I hope this answers the question. The question 246 goes like this. Does thinking and intending accumulate future karmic effects? Yes, it does, but to a very limited degree. So loose stray thought, the Buddha say, it accumulates karma, but it's very little. As soon as you start saying it to yourself internally, the same thing, oh, I will kill him or her, or I will steal this or that, or they are evil, or they are bad, blah, 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 all this accusation and blaming. Well, then you're repeating the same karma again and again and again. Thereby the effect is stacked up because these probabilities are additive. So 1% is formed, then 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%. Chance for feeling pain later down the road. As then, if it's come out in behavior, and you start doing something about it or saying to other people, then the karma is even stronger because now it's repeated again, the same issue about blaming or stealing or killing or whatever. So thinking accumulates little karma, saying verbal activity, saying it to yourself, saying it to others, more karma, doing it, performing it with the body, even more karma. What about dreaming? This was a question that was discussed very much at the time of the Buddha. And the dreaming, we can say for the general purpose, it doesn't accumulate karma. But nevertheless, it is good to look at one's dreams to see what's going on there. For example, if you kill somebody, then there must be anger in the mind since you killed somebody in a dream. Or if you have sex with somebody you shouldn't have sex with. Or if you drug during a dream. Whatever you do during this dream, then you can classify it under either greed, hate or ignorance. If it's one of these things. And then see what's there. And then one can learn a lot by looking at these dreams, these projections. But it doesn't, I think the general agreement is, it doesn't accumulate karma, or it accumulates very microscopic amount of karma to dream something. But thinking definitely do, but to a much lesser degree than saying it to yourself or saying it to others. So much for today. Thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Thanks to also to all the Dayakas and the supporters and the donors, especially those who have contributed with food and with regular donations and with a cost for the meditation hall construction, which will benefit many over the next 20, 30 years. May many beings become happy thereby. And may you have a very, 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 very nice and very noble day. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha, without any doubt. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.